by singing, Morning Has Broken.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for
in the name of the Lord.
Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.
Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee."
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palms along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
All glory.
Of righteousness, I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. He who is righteous may enter.
I may know how to sustain the weary with the word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen to those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me, who will declare me guilty. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read responsibly. Oh, let's pray in unison. Portion of Psalm 31.
Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly. For my life is wasted with grief, and my years are sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed. I have become a reproach to all my enemies, and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me. I have forgotten my
God.
said to them,
I am deeply grieved even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me.
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed,
My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want.
Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
So could you not stay awake for me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Again he went away for the second time and prayed,
My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done.
Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him.
At once he came up to Jesus and said,
Greetings, Rabbi.
And kissed him. Jesus said to him,
Friend, do what you are here to do.
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on the sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
Put away your sword back into your place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled.
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus, so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At least two came forward and said,
This fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.
The high priest stood up and said,
Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God.
Jesus said to him,
You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?
He deserves death.
Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying,
Prophesy to us, Messiah.
morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. He said,
I have sinned by betraying innocent blood.
But they said,
what is that to us? Seize it yourself.
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said,
it is not lawful to put them into treasury, since they are blood money.
After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for a potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus said,
you say so.
But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him,
do you not hear how many accusations they made against you?
But he gave them no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
whom do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, His wife sent word to him,
have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him.
Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
which one of the two do you want me to release for you?
And they said,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?
All of them said,
let him be crucified.
Then he asked,
why? What evil has he done?
But they shouted all the more,
let him be crucified.
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves.
Then the people as a whole answered,
his blood be on us and on our children.
So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him, mocking him, saying, hail, King of the Jews! They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head they put the charge against him, which read, this is Jesus, King of the Jews. Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on the right and one on his left. Those same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?"
That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
This man is calling for Elijah.
At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
Sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive. After 3 days I will rise again. Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people he has been raised from the dead.
Sometimes discover that there's is still a bigger hill to climb on the other side, a larger challenge that lay ahead of us. I remember it was the second marathon that I ran with my brother. It was in April of 2008 in St. Louis, around through the city and some of the suburbs. And we get about to the mile 10 marker, and we've been running on this flat area, and then all of a sudden we started going down this incline, this steady incline. And I thought, wow, this is great, you know. But then I look over, and it's a divided road, and I look over, and there's all these runners running up the hill. And I realized that they're the half marathoners who are going to the finish line. And I turned to my brother and I said, I think we're going to have to run that at the very end. And sure enough, we get going up that hill, and about halfway up it, I start cramping really bad. Also, another marathon that I've run several times, five or six times now, it's on Labor Day. It's the Heart of America Marathon in Columbia, Missouri. And it's got some rolling hills, and then it has about a 2 or 3 mile stretch along the Missouri River that's really flat. And you make really good time. You look at your watch and say, wow, I'm really doing great. But then you reach this hill called Easley Hill, and it's just about to the before the halfway point. And there are very few marathoners that run that hill. It is so steep, pretty much everybody has to walk it, and so you lose time. I've never climbed Mount Everest, but from what I've read about it, that climbers arduously climb to what they call the base camp, but then comes that last climb to the summit, and it has been the death march of many a climber. There is a woman on our prayer list, Margaret. She's my sister-in-law. She's currently walking the Appalachian Trail. She started on March 11th, and she's gotten over 100 miles so far. But if you know anything, the Appalachian Trail is 2,200 miles. And it starts at Springer Mountain, Georgia, and it ends at Mount Kedaden. And you have to be there by October the 15th, or they shut it down for the year. One thing about the Appalachian Trail is, and I walked sections of it back in 2015, is you climb up, you know, switchbacks up a hill, and you get to a certain point, and you think, oh, I've got to have reached the top, and then it goes up higher. There's another level that it goes up. Lent is a journey to the cross. Ash Wednesday is like the start of the gun going off, but I'm reminded of some of those longer runs in the Olympics where the gun goes off and they go running as fast as they can and they jockey for position and then they all slow down. So Lent it's not a sprint. It's not a 100-yard dash. It's more, reminds me more of a marathon. And we have to pace ourselves and discipline ourselves to achieve the resolutions and personal goals that we've set for ourselves during this season. That Easter chocolate starts to smell really good about the third week of Lent if you've given up chocolate. Or when another driver cuts you off on the west side of Evansville and you're really tempted to flip them off or honk your horn, even though you're resolved, be a calmer, more patient person during Lent. We celebrated and rejoiced 2 weeks ago when we reached the fourth Sunday of Lent, which was Rose Sunday. Even the color helped us to understand that we'd gotten over the hump of Lent and were in the home stretch towards Easter. People that when I've run marathons, people line the streets and they cheer runners on and they have encouraging and they say, looking good, keep it up, you're almost there. And my favorite, it's all downhill from here, which is typically usually a lie.
Yeah.
Like St. Lewis, Black Heart of America, like Mount Everest, there's still one last climb to the finish at Easter, to get to Easter in the empty tomb. For the season of Lent, we reach Rose Sunday and look ahead of us, and we see Palm Sunday and Holy Week. Jesus' triumphal entry should have been the finish line. Jesus had finally entered the city of the King of David to retake the throne and fulfill the promise of God made to David. Jesus was supposed to gather an army like David and slay the Goliath Romans and put the Jewish authorities in their place. Jesus climbed the hill to Jerusalem on the back of that little donkey and looked out and to see the daunting hill of Calvary and the cross. He may not have literally seen Golgotha, the place of the skull, from his vantage point, but he could clearly see that hill and that cross in his future. In the Gospels, Jesus repeatedly tells his disciples, "I'm going to Jerusalem to be handed over to the authorities and to be killed." But time and again, they just didn't understand. It was not a concept for their Messiah to die. He was supposed to be the Savior, warrior, king. And the Jewish authorities and even the people of his hometown, Nazareth, tried to kill him in various ways. They tried to push him over a cliff. And on another occasion, they tried to stone him to death. But Jesus knew that he would be lifted up. He knew his destiny was to be hung on a cross, to be crucified. We know the end of the story. We want to hurry past the cross to get to the glorious finish line. We want to get back to eating chocolate or whatever else we may have given up for Lent. However, we must walk every single step of the way with Jesus. Not just this coming week, but oftentimes, many times in our life. We face a life of conflicts and adversity and suffering. And sometimes, when we climb a hill of adversity, expecting the pain and the suffering to be over, we find that we have an even greater hill to climb and a larger battle to be fought. When we see that daunting obstacle in our path, we must remember this one important point. Jesus walked that same path. He knows the way, and he's cheering us on and walking beside us every agonizing step of the way. And Jesus gives us a glorious finish line called heaven and resurrection and eternal life. That's the gospel. That's the good news. Amen.
Amen.
receive this, our prayers, which we offer unto your divine majesty, beseeching you to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth your true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer your holy sacraments. We pray this week for the providence of the Episcopal Church of South Sudan in the Anglican Cycle of Prayer, and St. John's Lafayette, the Reverend Dr. Bradley Pace, the Reverend Jason Fortner, and the Diocesan Cycle of Prayer. We also pray for our companion diocese, the Diocese of Brasilia, and their Bishop Mauricio, and for our partnership with St. Andres Mouton in the Episcopal Diocese of Haiti. And to all your people, give your heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive your holy word, truly serving you in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech you also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold your gracious hand in all your works, that, rejoicing in your whole creation, they may honor you with their substance and be faithful stewards of your bounty. We give thanks today for the birthdays of Melanie Steele Harrison and Amy Steele. We also give thanks for Family Matters, Andrea Biggerstaff, and their board of directors. Are there other thanksgivings?
For the signs of spring, for the spring flowers.
For God's healing and protection.
For all the first responders who have helped people affected by recent tornadoes.
And we most humbly beseech thee of your goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We especially pray for those who are ill, Quincy Fitzgerald, Judy, Grant McLaughlin, Bobby Harper, Andy, and all those suffering from the COVID-19 virus. And we also pray for those with special needs, the Sobecks, Nick, Doris Gerton, Joe Brunner, the Harper family, the Hirschberg family, Ron Stover, Julie, Stephen and Carrie Grubbs, Austin, the Thompson family, Susan and Bill Gooden, Leon and Della, Margaret Rutherford, the Timmons and Collins families, Claire and Baby Vera. And we also bless your holy name for all your servants departed this life in your faith and fear, Mike Timmons, Terry Harper, Charlie Thompson, and Mary Hirschberg. Beseeching you to grant them continual growth in your love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of St. John, all your saints, that with them we may be partakers of your heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the word of God to all who truly turn unto him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit. Practice to
faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy and renewed by thy word and sacraments, and may come to the fullness of grace which thou hast prepared for those who love thee. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
service,
not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.